Hey folks, welcome back to the Rupedia world, and I am Abhinay Gupta. And today again, we are continuing with the Professional Ethics by the CA Act 1949. So in the previous lecture, we had a discussion on the clause number 8 of the first part and the first schedule, right? Part 1 of the first schedule, right? So we know that, yeah, when you are taking up an audit, it is a mandate for you to inform the previous auditor or the retiring auditor, right? So that you get an insight as to what was the reason, what made him quit the audit, or if it was a general term that his tenure was over, it quits. So whatever it be, in your case, it is better to be safe by communicating to him before taking up the assignment, so that if there is any scope of any misrepresentation or any kind of any information that would be beneficial for you to take a decision better, right? Then let's not lose on this scope. Okay, so we have had a detailed discussion on the clause number 8 in the previous lecture. Today we move ahead to understand certain guidelines issued by the council on the clause number 8, right? So the first thing that the council goes on to say is that, mighty chartered accountants, please do not be confused. When we say that you need to communicate to the previous auditor, means you just need to communicate. Please don't apply your brain, whether it is a statutory audit, it is a tax audit, concurrent audit, internal audit, whatever kind of audit it is. The requirement remains in all types of audit that you undertake. It is not subjective or specific to, for say, statutory audit or just to internal audit or something like that. It is a general requirement for all kinds of audit that you undertake, right? So that is the first guideline given by the council. So if you remember the text of clause 8, right, what does it say? It says that you should accept a position as an auditor previously held by another chartered accountant or a certified auditor who has been issued certificate under the restricted certificate rule 1932 without first communicating with him in writing. Right? That is the exact text of the clause number 8. Now, when you go through this text, we feel that, yeah, there are certain words that needs to be explained. Like, what is an audit that we're talking about in this clause? What is or who is the previous auditor? Right? What do you mean by the certificate that we talk over here? Been issued certificate, right? Which is also under the restricted certificate rule 1932. So what is a certificate over here? What is a report, and what is the difference between a certificate and a report? So these are certain things you need to understand before you take the concept ahead. Right? Because normally what we do is we go through the text, okay, this is it. But again, there is a challenge. You need to understand what a certificate is, what a report is, or how do you take a judgment. When you get a case study in the question, the case study may represent something entirely different, but you may go ahead with a layman understanding and say that yes, he has to take a approval. Maybe he does not. Right? So when you read the books of the various authors that are available in the market, you just go through these topics. You don't try to understand what these words are. Neither are there places where anybody has explained you this. Right? But try and understand, this is important for your knowledge. How do you take a judgment? In your examination, you get case study based questions. How do you apply your judgment on that? So these words have to be crystal clear with you. Right? So we start with the first word, which is audit. So what is audit? Where have you studied about this word, this term audit? If we reflect back to our standards on auditing, SA 200, which is the basic principle governing an audit, right? So that SA goes on to say in one line that audit is nothing but an independent examination of financial information of any entity, right? Independent examination of financial information. Right, that is the clear cut four words over there. But again, there is one thing added to it, that it is with a view of expressing an opinion thereon, that you are actually examining those financial information to express your opinion. So when it says this, then you should stop applying your brain and stop being molded or diverted by the terminologies like it's a profit-making organization, it's a non-profit-making organization, it's a very small organization, it's a very large organization, whatever kind of things come into your place. Whenever you know the crux that auditing is just an examination of the financial information in order to provide an opinion thereon. So whatever be those financial information, whatever be the size and the nature of the entity, it will be termed as audit. So don't be confused by the other add-ons in the questions in the examination. Clear with that? Now the next term for understanding is the previous auditor. Right? So who is a previous auditor? Previous auditor actually is that person who held the same or the similar position with the same or the similar scope of work immediately prior to you as an auditor. Right? Now when you say it is immediately prior to you, that does not necessarily mean that it was in the immediate preceding year. Mark the words. It never says about the auditor in the immediate preceding financial year. It says the auditor, which is immediate preceding auditor than you, with the same scope of work and the same or similar assignment. Right? So what do we conclude out of it? That there may be a chance that last year the client did not get itself audited. Forget about the case, whatever be the requirement, whether they should have got themselves audited, whether it is allowed for them not to get audited, whatever it is, that is a separate question altogether. But the point is, even if they did not get themselves audited in the previous year, but in the year preceding the previous year they got themselves audited, like there's a gap of 1 year, still that previous auditor will be the previous auditor for you, because he was the auditor for this company prior to you, whatever be the tenure, whatever be the year. But he was the one prior to you, there's no one in between. So when you get to communicate, you get to communicate directly with that person. Right? So these are very small details, right, that you need to understand, that you need to focus on. It never talks about the preceding year, it talks about the preceding auditor. Are you clear with it? Right? Now we move on to the next topic, which is the certificate. So basically, as an auditor, when you are there for an audit, you issue a report, right? You do not issue a certificate. But there are other cases, other instances where you are appointed to issue some certificates as well. Right? Now, what is the difference between the certificate and a report? This is not mandatorily a part of the clause, right? In the clause, you don't deal with the certificate and report. Over there, when it talks about the certificate, it talks about the certificate issued to that chartered accountant to be a chartered accountant. He is not issuing a certificate. But over here, the question is, he's taking up an assignment. Right? But in general, we need to understand what is the difference between the certificate and a report. So if you refer to the para 2.2 of the guidance note on the audit report and certificate for special purpose, these are two different things. Right? When you go for a statutory audit, internal audit, you give an audit report. But when you are appointed for some specific certification task, you provide a certificate. So when you go ahead to provide a certificate, right, that certificate actually ensures that the facts and the data are accurate. Right? Whatever is mentioned over there is 100% accurate. You have no opinion on that part. Right? It is not a human opinion, it is the factual data that is contained. That is a certificate. Right? Like if you have a birth certificate, I'll take a very simple example. Right? All of you require the birth certificate for your passport and for your Aadhaar and different stuff, right? So what is that birth certificate? Why is it called a birth certificate and not a birth report? Because the birth certificate actually gives the fact that yeah, this is the child, male, female. This is the weight, born in this place at this time. That is it. It is all factual data. They do not say, in my opinion, this is a guy, right? And I think he was born somewhere around 5 to 6 o'clock. It is not a report. It is a certificate. Exact time, exact gender, exact place. Right? It is a certificate. It authorizes the fact that yes, this is what had happened that day. It does not go ahead to give the doctor's opinion on it. Right? That is a very simple example that distinguishes between a certificate and a report. But when you actually, as a reporting auditor, go ahead to issue a report, the report will definitely contain your opinion. Right? No doubt. It will contain your opinion, but that opinion should be based on the factual data. Even that is required. Right? The basis of your opinion should be correct and it should be factual. Whereas in certificate, all the information should be factual. There is no opinion at all. So this is the basic difference between a certificate and a report that you need to understand. Because when you go for issuing certain certificates, understand there should be no opinion. And you should know what are you going up to do. Many a times people use these words simultaneously. Okay, we are issuing a certificate, we are issuing a report. But no, it's a huge difference between the two. You cannot issue a birth report, it's a birth certificate. You cannot issue an audit certificate, it's an auditor's report. It's an auditor's report because you have different kinds of opinions. Adverse, disclaimer, qualified, unqualified, whatever it be. Are clear with the fact? So, as per this clause, we need to understand that whenever you are going out to take up an assignment where you will be providing an opinion, right, it is a mandate requirement for you to communicate to the previous auditor. But that mandate is not applicable in case of certificates. In case of certificates, it's a healthy practice to communicate with the previous person who has issued the certificate. Right? And that is a healthy practice if he's a chartered accountant, and even if there is some other professional that has issued the certificate earlier, it's a healthy practice to communicate with him. But that is not a mandate. It's a mandate only in the case of the reports that you issue. When you have taken up an assignment where you give your opinion, over there it's a mandate. Right? So if you get a question where as an auditor or as a chartered accountant, you are supposed to issue a certificate, right, and you did not communicate, you will not be deemed to be guilty of professional misconduct. So be very careful in the examination. Just don't go ahead to say that, yeah, he is deemed to be guilty as per clause 8. No, if it's a certificate, it's a healthy practice. If it's a report, it's a mandate. So now that is the reason why I brought out the difference between the two. Right? So I hope this is very much clear with you, and in the next lecture we'll keep it short and complete this clause with the pending case studies. Right? We have certain case studies that have been discussed by the institute. I'll let you know about those case studies and what are those cases, so that it is easier for you to interpret the case studies in the examination. Right? And with that, we'll end the clause 8 and move on to the clause 9. Right? So until then, this is Abhinay Gupta signing off. Thank you and